anyway. All right, moving on. Are you ready? This person who's about to give this keynote address, I think is actually long overdue. Long overdue. I'm going to read a little bit of his bio because I think it's important. I really do. I'm just going to start reading. Jim Henry holds degrees in vocal music education, music theory, and music composition, including a PhD in music composition from Washington University. He is currently the director of choral studies at University of Missouri, St. Louis, where he conducts the university singers and the a cappella ensemble and teaches choral methods, choral arranging, and choral conducting. Prior to his appointment at UM St. Louis, he was head of the choral department at Lindenwood University for 9 years, during which time the university chorus quintupled in size under his leadership. He also formed Voices Only, a unique a cappella ensemble that performed to rave reviews at the 2004 Missouri Music Educators Association Conference, toured Germany, Holland, and Sweden, and produced a recording. In addition to his duties at UM St. Louis, Dr. Henry is the musical and artistic director of the Ambassadors of Harmony, 2007 Silver Medalist Chorus. I don't know about that. Anyway, Dr. Henry's singing experience spans classical music to jazz. He served as a bass section leader for the St. Louis Symphony Chorus and sang bass with Odyssey, a popular St. Louis-based jazz quartet. He also arranged and sang bass with the 1993 International Quartet Champions, the Gas House Gang. As a composer, Jim has won awards for his songs and piano pieces. He served for 3 years as composer in residence at Central Visual and Performing Arts High School under the aegis of Washington University and the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra and the Buter Foundation. He was also a music mentor for Music Words Opera Educational Program sponsored by the Opera Theater of St. Louis. Dr. Henry travels the world as a guest conductor, coach, and lecturer. He is also a contributing author for the New Encyclopedia of American Gospel Music. And it's amazing, you know, we see him all over the place doing barbershop. I don't know how he has time to do all this other stuff. But would you please welcome a hero, I think, of everybody's. Yeah, get it going! Dr. Jim Henry!
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, now it's very dark up here, and I can't even read what I wrote on my paper. And people who know me are going to be surprised that I'm reading it all anyway, but... I'm just very honored to be here. I thought people who do keynote addresses are either old or dead. And I saw, for instance, David Wright and Ed Watson do this thing. So I would just assume. But I do want to tell you how honored I am to be here this evening. I was 12 years old when I attended my first Harmony College, back when Bob Johnson stood in this spot, figuratively speaking, but over at the other hall. And like most students in those days, I was completely evangelized by Bob Johnson and also scared to death that he would make good on his promise to send home anyone who was caught singing a modern tag. If I catch you singing modern music, I'll send you home. And as a 12-year-old, I believed that, and maybe it really was true. And so I was scared of him. But I still sang modern tags now and then. But tag singing, if you wanted to do that back in those days, involved 5 people because 4 had to sing the tag and 1 had to stand up like a meerkat and look around for Bob Johnson to come by. And we got very good at going from any major 7th chord right into my Wild Irish Rose whenever we saw him coming. I also learned from some of Barbershop Society's most revered icons like Dave Stevens, Lou Perry, Mac Huff, Val Hicks, Greg Lyne, Eric Jackson, and others through the years at Harmony College, and from fellow adult students who took me under their wings, like Chuck Lauer, Bill Heyer, who I saw today, David Krause, Bob Landry, Gordon Lankenau, Ron Black, Rick Taylor, and countless others. And I can honestly say that this is the setting that really set me on the path that led to me being able to stand up here tonight and talk with you. I'm definitely a product of Harmony College and now Harmony University. So it really, truly is an honor. I'm so humbled to now be here to give this speech. In the introduction to his 1925 book of Negro Spirituals, James Weldon Johnson, a towering figure of the Harlem Renaissance, author, lyricist, composer, lawyer, civil rights leader, and founder of the NAACP, recalled a scene from his boyhood memories of Jacksonville, Florida, in the 1880s. See if it doesn't sound familiar to you. In the days when such a thing as a white barber was unknown in the South, every barbershop had its quartet, and the men spent their leisure time playing on the guitar and harmonizing. I have witnessed some of these explorations in the field of harmony and the scenes of hilarity and backslapping when a new and rich chord was discovered. There would be demands for repetitions and cries of, "Hold it! Hold it!" until it was firmly mastered. And well it was, for some of these chords were so new and strange for voices that, like Sullivan's lost chord, they would never have been found again, except for the celerity in which they were recaptured. In this way was born the famous, but much abused, barbershop chord. Now, in these days, when controversies about what does and what does not constitute barbershop fester incessantly, is "Surfer Girl" a barbershop song, for instance? It is reassuring to read an account from 125 years ago that describes exactly the same scene that takes place in nearly every corner of every barbershop harmony gathering around the world today. Never mind that these poor, ignorant souls from the last millennium didn't know that they weren't supposed to use a guitar. Or be unashamed about finding new chords with strange voicings. After all, they didn't have the contest rules or the sages of the harmonet to set them straight. And truth be told, they certainly would not have produced the clean, polished sound of a Max Q or OC Times or Vocal Spectrum or Real Time. They weren't singing for anybody but themselves, and they were loving every minute of it. A lot of things have changed, but that spirit that gripped those singers from two turns of the century ago is just as fresh and palpable today. It is that timeless spirit of barbershop and music in general that I want to talk about this evening. I bet that every singer in this room is here because at least one time in our life, a musical experience changed us in a significant way. I am blessed to remember several. I was in junior high.